Hi everyone, and hi Matt.
Hi Andre, how are you doing?
Very good, thanks. So what have you been up to in 2020?
So in 2020, we have finished our study of reserve parachutes. We have now flung 143 people either down a zipline or round a centrifuge arm. And I'm delighted to be here to tell you what we found.
So we've condensed everything down to 10 minutes. This was quite a challenge, but we're really proud of this video. And stick around to the end if you want to hear what it's like to pull 6G on a paraglider. Matt, take it away.
In 2019, 55 fantastic paraglider pilots took part in what was then the largest experiment of reserve parachute deployment ever conducted. Pilots were attached to a zipline. We stressed them out a little bit psychologically, and then we released them by surprise. They were briefed to throw their reserve parachute as fast as possible, and certainly before they reached the end of the line. That experiment was an amazing opportunity to understand pilot behaviour under stress, and also to study the performance of reserve parachute systems. We came to a few conclusions from that study. The first was that no matter where the reserve parachute handle was, paraglider pilots like to look for it on their hip. Then, once they found the handle, they like to pull that handle upwards, even if the harness said that they should pull it outwards. Once they managed to get their reserve parachute out, we found that throwing in a single sweeping action worked much better than trying to bring the parachute forwards and then throwing it back. When we looked at front-mounted reserves, we found that they needed to be secured at the base. If not, they could lift up. Finally, the experiment taught us that reserve parachute systems have to work right first time. When pilots are under stress, they can't innovate. They can't come up with solutions to even simple problems. So the system has to be perfect. In many ways, our experiment was very strong. However, lots of paragliding emergencies aren't linear. They don't involve people traveling forwards. So in the discussion that followed the experiment, it was widely pointed out that we needed to study this not just on a zipline, but also in rotation under G-force. So with the help of the DHV and the BHPA, we were put in touch with Flugschule Hochries, a paragliding school in Bavaria and home of the G-Force trainer. The Flugschule Hochries team, led by Jess and Sepp, did an incredible job getting together 88 amateur paraglider pilots, recruiting them to come and take part in what then became, following the zipline study, the largest reserve parachute study ever conducted. The 88 pilots were made up of 27 women and 61 men who flew an average of 30 hours per year. So importantly, they were amateur pilots just like us. When pilots arrived, they were given a standard briefing and they used their own equipment. The only things that we gave them were thin gloves and a standardized lightweight helmet. We also asked them to hold the brake lines in an open beginner grip. We were trying to simulate a paragliding emergency, so we wanted to give paraglider pilots a difficult task to do before the centrifuge started to spin. So we got them to look up at the LED lights and every time one went on, pull a brake line on the same side. We also asked them to name every word they could, beginning with a particular letter. The idea was at the point of deployment, their eyes would be looking up as if towards the wing, their hands would be in the brake lines, and their brain would be overwhelmed with the sensations of G-force and conflicting cognitive tasks. The centrifuge spun up over 12 to 14 seconds to the target G-loading, and once that G-loading was reached, a buzzer went, the lights turned red, and pilots were briefed to deploy as soon as possible. After they deployed, we slowed down the centrifuge, and then they went straight to an interview station, so we could capture as much information about their experience as possible. During an emergency, a paraglider can either spin forwards in a spiral type configuration, or they can spin backwards, almost like a sat. We wanted to simulate both. So half the pilots went forwards at 4G, like in a spiral, and the other half went backwards at 3G, like in a sat. So what did we find? Well, interestingly, even though sat was lower G, pilots seemed to find it more taxing. As the centrifuge arm spun up, fewer pilots in the sat configuration were able to do both the tasks. They also had this tendency, particularly in sat, to lock their hands closer to the stall position, well below the level of the carabiners, almost as if they were trying to brace themselves against the unfamiliar sensation. One of the key findings from the zipline study was paraglider pilots don't look for their reserve handles, they feel for them. On the zipline, 85% of paraglider pilots put their hand on their hip first when looking for the handle. In spiral, 83% of paraglider pilots did precisely the same thing. Their hands went straight to their hips. Interestingly though, when pilots were spun backwards in sat, 63% of them went for their thigh. So it seems like where pilots feel for the handle depends a little bit on the direction of travel. However, pilots always feel, it seems, overlying their skeleton, and when they couldn't find the handle first time, they tended to move their hands backwards and forwards along their thigh bone, searching for it. In the zipline study, we saw that paraglider pilots liked to encircle the handle with their finger and thumb before they threw. This was exactly the same under G-force, and we watched pilots struggle where the handles had been placed at unfamiliar angles or when they were too tight against the harness. 70% of pilots in the zipline study tried to pull their reserve parachute upwards, even if the harness had been designed for the parachutes to come out laterally. We watched pilots struggle and change their grips as the bag got stuck. In this experiment, only 50% of pilots pulled upwards, but we still saw some sticking, and we suspect that the difference was because the G-forces help fling the arm back and out, and also push the reserve parachute bag down a little bit in the harness. In the zipline study, we saw paraglider pilots trying to throw their parachute in a number of different ways. Interestingly, in the G-force study, everyone threw their parachutes back in a single sweep, and we suspect that this was due to the G-forces almost pulling the bag away from them. The other thing that came out of the interviews with the pilots afterwards is there was a general feeling that they lacked power and directional control when trying to throw the parachute, particularly in sat. 11 paraglider pilots in the study had front-mounted reserves, and we didn't see any difference in speed of deployment between front mounts and under seats. What we did see, which was fascinating, was that some pilots with front-mounted reserves, even though they could see it in front of them, still felt on their hip first for the handle. So what were the strengths and weaknesses of our study? Like in the zipline study, we had a large sample of amateur pilots using their own equipment. We had them do a proven standardized task under realistic forces and conditions of psychological stress. The weaknesses were also similar, and the key weakness of all of this work is that there's no real danger involved. Pilots are not going to hit the ground. There's no surprise. They know they're there to throw their reserve parachute, and there's no rush to throw. Throwing the reserve was always the right action. There was never that doubt of, ooh, should I throw? Am I too close to the ground? Should I try and fix my wing? The other weakness was we could only mount harnesses on the centrifuge in one direction, which meant that the reserve handle was always facing inwards in the rotation. We've now filmed over 140 amateur paraglider pilots throwing their reserve. In that number, we saw a failure rate of approximately 2.7%. If these were real emergencies, then the compounding effects of fear, uncertainty, the intense disorientation might mean that these numbers are even higher. This is something that as a community, we need to address it in terms of better equipment design and also in terms of better training. In general, we'd like to see standardization of reserve parachute equipment. This doesn't mean that everything has to be the same. It just means that when a paraglider pilot puts on a harness, they should expect to find the handle in the same place and to be able to throw the reserve parachute in exactly the same way. Based on the two experiments, we recommend that reserve parachute handles are positioned overlying the pilot's hip. Even though pilots may have searched further forwards in sat, they always use their skeleton to track back to their hip. Handles should be made prominent and big enough to be easily encircled with a gloved hand. The pilot should be able to extract the reserve from the container with any direction of pull. In harnesses that don't come with an integrated reserve bag, pilots should ensure that the strop connecting the handle to the reserve parachute bag is of the correct length. Front-mounted parachutes need to be secured at the base. Not everything about reserve parachutes can be fixed through changing design. We have to recognise that as pilots, we are an integral part of the reserve system. We need to increase our familiarity with the reserve parachutes by an order of magnitude. For students who are learning, they need to understand the reserve system and practice throwing over and over again. Pilots should be taught to throw the reserve parachute in a single sweeping backwards motion. Even if throwing in a particular direction makes theoretical sense to reduce the chance of entanglement, the important message should be kept simple. Get the reserve parachute out of the harness. Once qualified, we'd recommend that pilots throw their reserve parachute in training on things like ziplines, but also where possible in SIV courses over water. It needs to stop being this thing that sits underneath us that we never want to see. Finally, we would recommend that paraglider pilots adopt a post-takeoff check. In other words, when we're flying, we're safe, we're on glide, we take our hands out of the brake lines, we encircle the reserve with our hands, and we imagine what it would be like to throw. Finally, please remember that the mechanics of the reserve parachute throw are just one part of the whole chain. The most important thing is recognizing the need to throw and throwing early, maintaining that altitude awareness. Once the parachute has been thrown, the job's not done. We have to check it's not entangled with the main parachute, we have to disable the main parachute, and we have to prepare ourselves for landing. As with all the studies we do, this was an incredible team effort, and I'd like to thank all the pilots who volunteered to take part. Particular thanks are due to the study team, Geoff Long, Seli Metzger, Florian Heuber, Dave Thompson, Jessi Barlow, Hannah Müller, and Sepp Fasching. I'd also like to thank Robert Niederreuther from Flugschule Hochries, the Extreme Environments Laboratory, University of Portsmouth, the BHPA, Karl Slezak and the DHV, Dr Becky Charles and her team of ergonomists at the Rail Safety and Standards Board who helped analyse the results, Ed Ewing and Cross Country Magazine, the team at Flyo, Lanarkshire and Lothian Soaring Club, and the Scottish Hang Gliding and Paragliding Federation and the Royal Aeronautical Society, all of whom helped fund the work. Thank you so much for watching. We hope you enjoyed that. We know it's a lot of information in a short period of time. If you'd like to know more, then the paper from the Zipline is linked underneath the video, and the scientific paper from the G-force study will be linked as soon as it's ready.
Matt, let's be honest here. Did you have a go on the centrifuge?
I absolutely had a go on the centrifuge. It was such good fun. It was amazing. I got up to 6G when we were practicing, and it was brilliant because Jessi, from Flugschule Hochries, who's used to training people on G-force, was able to kind of instruct me in the breathing exercises, and we managed to control my vision just through breathing. It would narrow with the G-force, and then you'd do the G-straining maneuvers and the vision would open up again. I can't recommend it enough.
So cool. And how do you think that compares to doing an actual spiral on a paraglider? Pretty close?
Pretty close. I think it depends how much you like control. So at least when you're spinning on a paraglider, it's really intense. There's wind noise. You see the world going around you, but you're in control. Whereas I think on the G-force sim, you're kind of at somebody else's mercy.
Yeah. Cool. Well, thank you so much for all your work and for all your team's work, Matt. We really appreciate it. I want to say thank you from the community. Also, I want to say a big thank you to all of these people that support the channel on Patreon and on YouTube memberships. Thank you all for making these videos possible. And subscribe if you haven't already, and you'll hear more from us very soon. Bye-bye.